Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's a spectrum analyzer from Hameg, model 5005. So this is a 500 megahertz spectrum analyzer, and it's all analog. I mean, it's not storing, digitizing, and all that kind of stuff. There is a digital interface to the sweeps and bandwidth selections and all that kind of stuff. But other than that, it's a purely analog spectrum analyzer. So what you see is what you get in absolute real-time sweep. And it is very, very fast real-time kind of feeling. So when you're working with like analog stuff that responds fast, frequency hopping stuff, spectrum kind of stuff, anything that's demodulating stuff, this one is amazingly cool to work with. Definitely a keeper. So absolutely nice. But before I power this up, I need to open it. It's full of some funky stuff that's like rattling around, so I don't dare to power it up. But meanwhile, I just wanted to, I got the manual for it as well. It's quite all right. There isn't any schematics, and it says more or less everything about its use. It was about this frequency range here. It's 0.15 megahertz to 500. Four-digit display. So that means we got 0.1 megahertz resolution in the readout, right? But look at that, the amplitude range is from minus 100 to plus 13. So that is actually quite all right. So yeah, okay, you can see this is not super microhertz video resolution and all that kind of stuff. And this is of course, because it's purely analog, the way that it's sweeping, and you need it to be sweeping real fast, otherwise you can't see anything, right? Yeah, but we need to open this. So now we're inside. This is a beautiful spectrum analyzer. It's really nice and clean. And its design setup and everything here is very impressive. Of course, there's quite a lot of air in this cabinet, but that's quite all right, I think. It was, by the way, it was full of all this little solder dust particles you have in the bottom of your soldering iron holder. It was just full of that kind of stuff. So I bet it was transported or stored somewhere, and this somebody put his soldering iron on top of this and then flipped it, and then I didn't realize, and then half of it just went through the holes and it was in here. That was bad. So I think it was a good idea that I took it and removed all that before playing around with this and turning it on. It's a very modern design. I think maybe this is the year 2001, and it's SMD on a two-layer board. We got SMD and normal ICs in sockets, as well as SMD transistors and resistors and all that kind of stuff. It's mainly MELF resistors, so those are really, really nice and good. It's about 1206 size, more or less all the passive SMD components. So it's, here's a timing. A crystal setup for, I bet that will be sweep ramps and stuff like that. There's actually also a PLL handling the sweeps and the frequency readouts. So that's the frequencies for all this span and marker stuff. And here's the power supply. I believe this model here that we have here is a linear or more normal kind of power supply. They also have a switch mode model, but in this one, when I look at it, it looks like the transformer is mains frequency. I think we should probably open here. So it's, I kind of like the idea about having the transformer as far away from the CRT as possible and inside completely enclosed cabinets like this. And also you see the CRT is magnetically shielded, so that's also very good. Got some voltage regulators and stuff sticking out here, 2000 volts, yes. The cathode is at minus 2000. So they just did it a little bit protected like that. I believe we got the yeah, here we go. That will be some of the deflection or CRT drive stuff. Is that really the deflection transistors? Those tiny little ones, but yeah, I guess it is. And that is of course because this the scan and sweeps and all that kind of stuff is really running at slow speeds. So this is why you can use tiny little transistors like that. You see this mechanically connected with those rods to the front plate stuff here. That's a good idea because you want all the high voltage stuff to be as local as possible. So all that is super nice. It's, yeah, great layout, great design so far. I really want to have a look inside the RF section. We should probably just unscrew most of that. Yeah, I think we should be able to get into the RF section where we're gonna find the oscillator and mixer and all that kind of stuff. So now we're inside the RF section, and look what, they're using a commercial receiver front end, or like a tuner. So, and this is a classic thing because those tuners are super, super wide band and very, very easy to use and interface to. So, of course they're doing it like that. And here is the input, and we got all those switches here, they're attenuators. So they're just behind the shield in here. They really tried to shield stuff and make it as RF goody-goody as they could. So that's of course everything of all the super high frequency stuff that is in here. And if we look at the block diagram, the tracking generator is not in my model here, so forget about this. So here we go with the upper left, that is the input and the attenuators and all that kind of stuff. That is on a little separate block, so this explains that first part. And here is the RF unit, so all this here is this first metal case. So that consists of a local oscillator, and that local oscillator runs at a frequency from 610 to 1100, and that goes to the first mixer. And then there's a band pass filter 609, so that is the first IF amplifier. So there's another local oscillator and a PLL, so that is definitely a low frequency oscillator. And then it makes it into a 29 megahertz, and then we go down to, what is that, 2.9 megahertz. So the last one here is 2.9 megahertz, different bandpass filters. And then you select your filters, and then there's a detector. All this kind of stuff here, that is of course the last box. And then the detector is also in here, and it goes to the video filter Y and X amplifier that drives the CRT deflection. And that XYF, that means X and Y final amplifiers. That was this this board we talked about before. This is driving the CRT, and that will be the deflection transistor. So that is all there is to it, more or less. And that is the digital board with all the sweep and the PLLing for measuring the frequencies and markers, they will be added on, all those kinds of things. And then there's a little LED display. Oh, quite nice. So what else can we do here? Let's try and look inside the power supply. But I really want to. Can we pull this cover off here? Yeah, so now we're inside the power supply. And I immediately see something funny. So this is the mains on-off switch. And everything here seems to be good isolated. You see the distance to metal is good in the design more or less here, right? So here is a very thin, see, you can easily bend this, and it is of course mounted like that, right? See, there is a hole here in this plate that is made for this little metal thing, and it is supposed to be all this way down. Otherwise this push rod here for the on-off switch is gonna be bent, and then it doesn't really work that well. But look what they've done. They have added silicone isolation on the pins, and they have to cut the pins. And I bet it's only half of the switch that is used, I mean the upper pins here, and that is to create a safe distance. So they probably failed isolation tests, and then they tried to fix it this way. And so this silicone glue here is a very, very effective isolator, and now they're passing the high voltage security tests. Other than that, this whole power supply here is a very, very classic. I'm not super surprised about anything really. Got a good iron core transformer, rectifiers, and all this classic stuff. Nothing super surprising anywhere really. That will be all the red capacitors here and all those diodes here. That is what is making the minus 2000 volts for the cathode. And deflection runs off a 140 volts positive, because that is on its way to the anode, obviously. Made in Germany, of course. So how about we power it up and see how it works. So here is how it works. I am now in the highest bandwidth. So in that is 50 megahertz per division. As it says here, we got 10 divisions. So that is 500 megahertz. What you see here is the 0 hertz beat. So that's actually the first oscillator that goes straight through the mixer and straight through the bandpass filter. So that is why there is a peak like that. This is actually the level of the first oscillator that you see here. And you always dial this in to your zero. And this way you just know that this is 0 hertz. So it's quite convenient actually. In this full span modes, all the PLLs and the stuff for reading out stuff is of course not able to lock to anything, and that is why you see this on calibrated things. So if I input a 100 megahertz signal, as you see here, it's of course 2 divisions, that is 100. I think you can even see, you can add a marker if you want to. Let's pretend that we don't know what frequency that is, and then you can dial around with your marker, as you see here, and then when they collide, see, whoop, they add. How cute is that? And then it reads out 101. So this is just the accuracy of this analog sweeped mode. And I mean, that is quite all right. This is 1%. I mean, that is nice, isn't it? We can turn off the marker again. So what if we go into a 20 megahertz span? So now we don't see our 100 megahertz, and that is because our center frequency is now off. Here is 100 megahertz, and it is now in the center, right? So now you can do, why, when you have the wanted frequency in the center, and then you dial down bandwidth, then it should stay more or less in the center. And then you can move it like this. 1 megahertz per division. So, oh, look what happened here. 500 kilohertz per division, and now we're in lock, and that means now we can measure really accurate stuff. See here? It's also getting much more aggressive. But now we have a correct reading. Let's try and see how. So that is 50 kilohertz. Ooh, do I dare to touch this? Let's see if they... Oh, the markers, of course, scaled to that. How cute. And then here's the readout. Of course, we could have wanted some more digits here, but that is actually really nice. And look at the update speed. It's lightning fast. I mean, look at that. I'll look at something here. So this is AM modulation, 50 hertz. And look at the display. It's just absolutely fantastic. So that is AM. How about we try some FM deviation? Okay, we should change the frequency. Let's go to 50 hertz. See, that is 50 kilohertz of FM modulation, and that is 50 hertz. And then it goes like that. It's definitely not looking like that on a sampling spectrum analyzer. I don't know how this is picked up by the camera, because the camera is only 30 frames per second. But this looks insanely live to my eyes. It's really, really fast and fantastic. And this is definitely one of the things I totally love about this machine here. Its update speed is just amazing. And that is, of course, in zero. In zero, well, we normally call it zero span, but here's zero scan. Cool. And then it becomes time. Your modulation, so let's turn off the frequency. All right, so there's only one last thing to say, and that is thank you very much for watching. That's the analog interface for the deflection board. I know, I just couldn't resist inputting my little Vector logo into the deflection board. And there you have it. If you want to know how I made this little Vector deflection board, you can also find a video about that.